Have you heard the term statin intolerance? Well, we ought to call it what it really is, and that's statin toxicity. Let's have a discussion about that. Stay tuned. So here's a taxonomy that I came up with for discussing statin intolerance. First, there's physical intolerance. That's the adverse effects that we feel, also known as statin toxicity. Psychological intolerance. Well, that's the nocebo effect, which does occur. I think it's rolled out too easily by doctors, but it can occur. Or we may have anxiety from the thought of taking the statins. And then there's the philosophical intolerance. You may have a distaste for lifetime medications. You may have a distrust of big pharma. You may find the evidence either unconvincing or underwhelming. In this video, we'll be talking about that first one. I'll get to the others in subsequent videos. Most of the information that I'll be presenting in this video comes from this paper in Circulation Research, which is something having to do with the American Heart Association. I downloaded the paper. I'll put a link to it in the description. And the name of it is Statin Toxicity, Mechanistic Insights and Clinical Implications, published in 2019, so not too old. So here's how it's laid out. Starts out with a statement of faith or opening prayer. Anything that you get published in an AHA journal of some kind has to have this statement of faith. And the first sentence says it all. There is now overwhelming evidence to support lowering LDL-C to reduce cardiovascular morbidity and mortality. So if you don't have that in your paper, you're not going to get it published. So that's why I say the statement of faith has to come up first. And then they go into three pages of a description of statins and their benefits and how they work. And then they go into 20 pages of statin toxicity, all the things that can go wrong and some proposed mechanisms for why those things are happening. Then there's 8 pages of miscellaneous topics, and I don't mean to trivialize them by calling them miscellaneous. They're important things like toxicity markers, a little bit about the nocebo effect, and a few other things like alternative treatment options. And then finally, there's a half-page conclusion. In this paper, the most common adverse effect listed is called SAMS, or statin-associated muscle symptoms. And I'll get into a little more detail in a little while. But also listed as some of the more serious adverse effects, there's new onset type 2 diabetes, neurocognitive effects, and whenever you see the neuro in there, that means it has to do with either our brain or our nervous system. Hepatotoxicity, that prefix there tells us it has to do with the liver. Think of hepatitis, we know that's a liver disease. Renal toxicity, again, renal is referring to the kidneys. And hemorrhagic stroke. Now, statins are supposed to prevent cardiovascular events, and a stroke, a ischemic stroke, is a cardiovascular event in the sense that, you know, a clot breaks off in an artery, lodges in the brain, causes a stroke there. That's analogous to a heart attack. A hemorrhagic stroke is actually from within the brain. An aneurysm could cause a hemorrhagic stroke. So while we're trying to prevent ischemic strokes, we're increasing the possibility of hemorrhagic strokes. Now, the numbers aren't here. It's not like, okay, it's a one-for-one trade-off. There's probably a lot fewer hemorrhagic strokes, in fairness to statins, than maybe the number of ischemic strokes that the statins can prevent. So what's the frequency of toxicity? Well, according to this paper, observational studies put it at 10 to 15%. That's 1 out of 10 to 1 out of 6 or 7 people. Clinic data, they don't define what clinic data is, but I believe what they mean is basically out in the field, you know, your doctor's office, that kind of clinic. It's not clinical trials. That's a different term. Up to 30%, almost 1 out of 3 people. That's pretty high. And then there's controlled trials, and controlled trials only report 1.5 to 5%. But these controlled trials aren't necessarily designed to be detecting statin intolerance or toxicity. They exclude patients with known statin intolerance because they don't want to put the patients through that, because that's not what the trial is for. These particular trials are usually to try figuring out the effectiveness of the statin, not the tolerability of the statin. So we can't cite those trials as a measure of statin toxicity. This is not a review of the paper per se. I'm just pulling out some things that struck me as I was reading through it. Here's some of the bad things that statin do. First, statins hurt the most vulnerable, and that's the elderly, because the elderly quite often have compromised systems, have a compromised liver, have compromised kidneys. And those are the ones that we give it to the most. It hastens their poor health. So that's the first thing that was noted. Age was considered the main indicator of statin intolerance. Muscle problems, SAMS that I mentioned before. There's myalgia, that is muscle pain. Myopathy, that is skeletomuscular problems. Rhabdomyolysis, that's when the muscles start to disintegrate and the byproducts of that disintegration get into your circulatory system and into organs. It is a often fatal condition, very dangerous. And then there's necrotizing myositis. Now, the MYA, MYO, that's a clue that we're talking about muscles. The term necrotizing, oh, you never want to hear that when talking about your body, because the necro means something's dying. So this is when muscles actually die. They also alter mitochondrial function. I talked about that briefly when I talked about CoQ10, but the mitochondria depends on the CoQ10, which statins are preventing from being produced within your body. And there's also a reduction in biochemical end products, not just CoQ10, that play a role in cell maintenance, growth, and limiting apoptosis, if I pronounced that right. Now, you probably have a gut feel for what cell maintenance is and growth is. This other term, this apoptosis term, that is actually the natural cell death that occurs in all humans, and it's a controlled process within our bodies, and statins reduce the products that help control that process. In other words, give it free rein. Since it's part of normal aging and we're kind of taking the controls off, maybe that's why statins seem to mimic the conditions of aging. More bad things that statins do. Well, they push type 2 diabetes over the edge. Now, there's a lot of talk about type 2 diabetes and how statins will increase the chances of it. I don't think it creates type 2 diabetes out of nowhere. If you have an HbA1c, for example, of 5.0, it's not going to make you a raging diabetic out of that. But if you're on the edge, you know, maybe you're 5.0, maybe become a 5.2. Well, okay, not much harm there. But if your 6.3 becomes a 6.5, well, now you're going to be officially diagnosed as having diabetes. The problem is it's like it's treated like a step function. Like 6.4, you don't have diabetes. 6.5, you do. You know, 6.4, you're pre-diabetic. So I think what it does is it probably pushes everybody or a large segment of the population up a little bit. And that's enough to push some people over the edge and make them officially diabetic. Cognitive effects. Well, this was an interesting quote that I saw in there. It said, it should be noted that cognitive effects may not be specific to statins per se, and instead a result of low cholesterol levels. Well, that's a distinction without meaning, because if the statins are lowering the cholesterol level and low cholesterol levels are causing cognitive problems, the statins are behind it no matter what. But this is interesting because I've always suspected that it was low cholesterol that was causing the problems with my mental health and my cognitive functions, because they happen a little bit even when they put me on some other non-statin cholesterol lowering agents. I don't take any anymore. But low cholesterol levels, it's acknowledged right here, low cholesterol levels are bad for your brain health. So let's talk about one of those cognitive effects, and that's an increase in depression. I'm going to use this to actually talk about statistical significance, because a lot of times things get reported as not statistically significant, and we really ought to understand what that means. So first of all, simvastatin, or Zocor, was seen to increase depression in the population taking it by about 9%. Now, the baseline depression rate in the United States, I read somewhere, is about 3%. So a 9% increase there is not 12%. It's actually 9% of 3%. This is a relative risk increase. So it would only be 3.27%. So it's that kind of increase. What they do with statistics is they use a 95% confidence interval. In other words, if they're 95% confident that the effect they're observing is not just by chance, randomness, then they'll come out and say, this is a statistically significant finding. And for simvastatin, it was, because we see the 95% confidence interval ranges from 2% up to 16%. That's that 1.02 to the 1.16. So in other words, they're 95% confident that having observed this 9% increase, that the actual population, there is a small but real increase up to a 16% increase and those are relative increases. And the p-value, there's a little bit of controversy about that, but that is basically the probability that the null hypothesis here would be that statins are not increasing depression. That's the probability that that would be true and you could still observe in the population, in the test subjects, a 9% increase or more. So it's slightly different than the probability that the null hypothesis, which is statins don't cause an increase in depression, is actually true. Those are slightly different, and I know statisticians out there probably are rolling their eyes at my explanation, and if you have a better way of putting it, please put it in the comments. And this is, by the way, from a study where they were comparing fat-soluble statins and water-soluble statins for their effect on depression. And for these are all fat-soluble ones. Crestor is the main water-soluble one. And for lovastatin and atorvastatin, Mevacor and Lipitor, the risk factors were 7% relative risk or 5% relative risk, but the 95% confidence interval, actually the lower end is below 1, which means, yeah, we're not confident to the 95% level that this statin is causing the increase in depression. Could be just random from the population. But you'll notice that it still goes higher to the, yeah, it is causing it, than the upper end of the confidence interval is farther from 1 than the lower end is below 1. Well, we can say these are not statistically significant, and quite often that phrase will be rolled out to just like say, yeah, it's not, there's no effect there. That's not really the truth here. It is not significant enough for us to be 95% confident that we're not just observing a random effect, but it is still more likely than not that these statins are causing an increase in depression among the users of the medication. It's the same mistake that a lot of political commentators make when they're looking at poll results before an election, and candidate A leads candidate B 51-48, but the margin of error is 3.5%. So therefore, this is a statistical tie. It is not a statistical tie in that case. It is more likely that the candidate who's ahead is still going to win the election. Same thing here. It's more likely that the statin is causing depression than not. It's just not so likely that we can pin that 95% confidence interval on it. So in this case, in the case of a lovastatin, there's a 1 out of 3 chance that, yeah, it's just random, but there's a 2 out of 3 chance that this is real. And how could we maybe tighten that? Well, you have to have a bigger sample size. The problem is when you're talking about a low base level, such as 3% of depression amongst the general population in the United States, showing a 9% relative increase in that is only going from 3% to 3.27%. That's very difficult to show unless you have a massively large base of patients to look at. If there was something that was happening 50% of the time, and a 9% increase from that would be like from 50 to 54.5%, that's actually easier to show, just the way the statistics work. So my point is, if something is not statistically significant, that is not the same as saying that there's no evidence. It just means we don't have enough evidence to say definitively, or a 19 out of 20 chance, that that's really what's happening. But it's still more likely happening than not. So let's talk quickly about liver and kidney. Well, there was a Spanish hepatotoxicity registry where they found that statins were the most frequent drug type associated with liver poisoning, basically. 5% of all cases, but of all the drug-induced cases, statins were the most common drug associated with it. Now, you know, there are probably all sorts of liver problems from alcoholism, that sort of thing. It's not all due to medications, but among those that were due to medications, statins were the most common. There was also an Italian study that showed that high doses of statins resulted in acute kidney injury within 6 months, about 1 in 690, a fraction of 1%, so it's not real frequent. But the point of the study was that people on lower doses of statins didn't have that kidney injury at that rate. But after 12 months, the two rates were the same. That makes sense to me because that's just basically saying it's an accumulated thing. The more statins in your system, the more cases of kidney injury are going to accumulate. So what's the upshot of all of this? Well, around the end of this paper, they mentioned that 40% to 75% of patients stop statin therapy within 1 year of initiating it. That's a big problem. We agree on that, except we're coming at it from different directions. So while we may agree with the statement that that is a problem, we don't agree on why that's a problem. Well, their solution, and I agree with their solution to it, is providing evidence-based counseling about statin therapy, its benefits and its adverse effects, and shared decision-making between the patient and the doctors. Will that help reduce the number of patients who stop statin therapy within 1 year? Well, they're thinking that yeah, more people will gut it out and keep taking the statins because they'll be convinced of the benefits. I think if you give honest information to the patients, the number of people who drop statins within a year will decrease. But the reason will be a lot fewer will even start taking statins if you give them honest information. Yeah, will better communications help? Of course it will. A lot fewer people will submit to being lab rats. So thanks for listening to me rant on this one. If you appreciate this content, please like, share, and comment. Subscribe if you haven't subscribed yet. We're coming up on 1,000 subscribers as I record this, which just boggles my mind that with only 17 videos, there's already enough interest in this. So I thank all my viewers for that. Please comment on any topics you'd like me to cover. And if you haven't seen this video, I recommend you take a look at it now. Thanks for listening.